Now that
was that was
that was a different sound. A very different sound.
Yeah. It's not the first time you've said that it's a different sound.
But this was really a different sound.
Yeah, so how did you feel about the difference?
I love it. It's a warm song that kind of made me... You're gonna hate me now. Kind of made gave me the vibes of... Dolly Parton. When you wake up, you
know where you are. Sometimes I do.
Sometimes I don't.
Yeah, yeah, okay. Yeah. That's good. That's really good, though. That's a good reference.
Good.
She's written some fantastic songs, though, Dolly Parton. Well, you know, Jolene.
Jolene, Jolene.
Yeah.
I Will Always Love You. Dolly Parton is great. It's kind of cowboy-ish, western.
Didn't she sing together like a duet with some guy? Kenny Rogers.
Yeah, yeah.
So you're kind of like...
Yeah, so this is me and Karen doing our Dolly Parton, Kenny Rogers.
Yeah.
It's good to be Kenny Rogers sometimes, though.
You know, Christopher's mornings like these remind me of when I was a little boy.
Yeah, yeah, suits you.
Speaking about the music, first off, I don't know, it's less country that you would think. I think it has to do with that slide guitar coming in.
Yeah.
That just reference-wise is just flying into...
And Colin doing a lot of the lead vocals.
Yeah, yeah, that's true. Vocally, that's true. But I think that if you remove those two elements, that it's actually more... Yeah, it's a bit hard to say.
But it's also the sadness, though.
Like, yeah, yeah,
a lot
yeah.
of country songs
you're right.
are beautiful sad.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
And that's the vibe I got from this one.
I've been a huge fan of people like Johnny Cash for a long time. I've also been, since I was a teenager, a really big fan of Rolling Stones. Beatles, too.
Friends. Changed your life.
I was a massive Rolling Stones fan, and I was a really big fan of how the Rolling Stones had these sort of country-ish songs in between all of the rock stuff. Like on Exile on Main Street, you would have all of a sudden this song coming in, and it's so good. And they used to hang around with Gram Parsons, and at that time when I was a teenager, by the end of the 90s, that's the worst time in music ever. And I think a lot of people thought so, because it was a time of new metal and all of that. It was shit. But it was...
Korn, Cold Chamber.
Limp Bizkit. It's like the dark ages of music. I guess for us who was teenagers throughout the grunge era, it was damnation those years. So for
Nirvana?
Me...
Nirvana?
No, the after the grunge.
Okay, now.
Late 90s, okay. Those years by the end of the 90s, it was shit. At that time, I forgot about all heavy music, all rock music just out the window. I was totally tired of it, so I started picking up all of this, you know, Kris Kristofferson and Johnny Cash, all of this country music. And I got really into Gram Parsons. And via Gram Parsons, he was friends with Keith Richards, hanging out with the Rolling Stones. And actually, via Gram Parsons, I got really, really intensely into the Rolling Stones for a while. And back into rock music. That was when we started Arabrock, actually. That was then in the early 2000s.
You're like, all music is shit. I should start a band so I can start making some good.
Yeah, yeah. I was really into Captain B. I started going into the post-punk thing, like Père Ubu, and then into punk from the early 80s, the Kennedys and all of these bands. There was country music for a long time, you know, and like country rock music or whatever. I guess some of those elements come back sometimes.
It's like a homage to what kind of got you into starting.
In a way, yes.
Now you really fucked yourself because you have to have this song now on the album. Because it's kind of like an important one now.
Yeah, it's kind of an outsider, but I think it's a good outsider. Lyrically, it worked. Me and Karen went to France outside of Nice, and I was sitting in this garden. It was really warm, you know, like southern France, the way you can only be there. And I was reading a book about Max Ernst, one of my absolute favorite artists. I was reading this book, this Taschen book that I just bought, and so into his pictures. I was probably, you know, drinking wine and listening to the sounds around, and there was this lemon tree garden or whatever, and I could kind of envision like parts of these pictures and I saw these strange figures that remind me of, you remember the, well, you do, of course, the Marilyn Manson Beautiful People video.
Yeah.
People that are on like stilts. I kind of saw those guys in that lemon tree garden. Weird, like cones spinning on their own, spinning around on cones, like those stilt people, like crazy figures, because this art is that way. So I wrote the lyrics for Sons and Daughters.
That's a lot of inspiration put into one song.
Yeah, I know. And Karen says that, oh, so Sons and Daughters, because I kind of thought of those crazy figures reproducing and kind of getting sons and daughters. So the lines are, they produce terrors soon, sons and daughters. But I don't know, Karen kind of thinks that it's maybe subconsciously, because we're going to have a kid and we have the aura baby, Lydia. I don't really think so, but whatever. You can buy the record, read the lyrics, listen to the song, and your own interpretation. That's fine with me. Here's another book of Max Sounds, which is a Norwegian translation by Einar Ekland. He's from...
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, it's not Haugesund, but it's Sveio, is it? Yeah.
Sveio? What? That's pretty insane.
Local. The pictures, they're really good, Max Sounds. And the lyrics, too, it's good. Kind of Maldororish.
Whoa, damn, it's pretty cool.
It's good.
Yeah.
Max Ernst.
What the fuck is crucified? Like a dragon or
something? No, it is a guy who's been eaten by vultures, but then there is the bride down there with the kids.
Shit. Sons and daughters.
Oh my god, yeah.
What are we expecting now?
Yeah, we've gone from... Oh, so far, what have we done?
Shit, it's been so much. This album is the most split genre album I've heard in a long time.
Oh my god, that sounds terrible. I usually hate that when people do that.
Dude, it's awesome.
That's what you get if you have a record collection which is really diverse, I guess.
That's just a good thing.
I guess it's a good thing. It feels schizophrenic though if it divides too much.
But that's the clue here. You have a lot of different sounds, but still at the same time you have the backbone of what we all know as Aurobot. You hear
that sounds good.
Yeah, you hear the bloodline. It's going through all the songs.
I'm glad you say that.
Yeah, of course. Go for the low headbang. Yeah?
It was a time of new metal and all of that. It was shit. But anyways, maybe you disagree, you new metal guy.
Well, well, Karen, here we are. Chetla has an English accent when he talks.
Dirty, dirty.
Yeah, oh.
But that's the interesting part about Aurobot, that it's constantly evolving.
If somebody had a knife against your throat and said, what genre is Aurobot?
Wanting to buy Aurobot records.